So in general, when you hear the term epidemiological transition, what people are referring to is this change in the burden of disease from infectious disease or communicable disease to non-communicable disease or chronic disease. And we're seeing this process at the moment predominantly in low and middle income countries. Now, to understand this better, what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at the history of epidemiological transition. So how did we get to where we are right now? And we're going to take a look at what the future has in store for us, because this process is far from over.
Please hang up and try again.
In 1971, Abdul Omran proposed his theory as to how it is that patterns of mortality have changed over time. Omran proposed that there's been three phases of epidemiological transition. So let's take a look at these. Phase one, pestilence and famine. From prehistory to the mid-18th century, infectious disease was the major cause of death, especially once people started living in close proximity in city-states. Travel and trade between city-states allowed for diseases like plague to have a devastating effect on the population. Plague killed about 25 million people, that's about a third of the population in Europe, in just 5 years. And during this time, there were, of course, other important causes of death. Things like war and famine killed lots of people. And low standard of living, poor hygiene, and no access to effective healthcare were important drivers of death and disease at this time. Phase two, the age of receding pandemics. Between the middle of the 18th and the middle of the 20th century, with the Industrial Revolution came improved nutrition, sanitation, and medical care. This resulted in massive reduction in the spread of infectious disease and epidemics. And this, of course, didn't apply to all people. Many people living in squalid conditions in cities died of diseases like cholera. Phase three, degenerative disease. As of the middle of the 20th century, due to vaccines, antibiotics, and improvement in the social determinants of health, we've seen an increase in life expectancy, and with that, we've seen an increase in the diseases that are prevalent amongst the elderly. Things like heart disease, stroke, cancer, and other chronic diseases. A more sedentary lifestyle together with dietary changes have also contributed to an increase in obesity, which itself is a risk factor for things like diabetes, heart disease, cancer, etc., etc. Just to give you a sense of the scale of the problem, non-communicable disease today kills 40 million people every year. That's about 70% of all deaths globally. 15 million of these people are relatively young, between the ages of 30 and 69. And 80% of these premature deaths, many of which are preventable, occur in low and middle income countries. Tobacco alone accounts for 7.2 million deaths every year, and this is projected to increase over the coming years. Now, the problem in many developing countries is that this process of epidemiological transition is taking place, firstly, very quickly, and secondly, is taking place at a time when there are existing social disparities. And that means that what's happening there is we're seeing a double burden of disease. We're seeing existing infectious diseases, and that's still a problem, and we're seeing the emergence of huge numbers of chronic disease. And these countries' health systems, due to resource constraints, are just not geared up to deal with this double burden of disease. For a country to address non-communicable disease, there's a couple of challenges. Let's take a quick look at why it's tricky. Patients require ongoing treatment for chronic conditions, so it's not as simple as just giving an antibiotic and walking away. Prevention is difficult, and prevention requires lifestyle changes. People living in poor countries often live in extremely challenging circumstances, and they don't have the luxury to spend time on Wikipedia figuring out how to design a lifestyle diet low in trans fats. To manage chronic disease, you often need multidisciplinary teams, and these often just don't exist in low-resource settings. Managing chronic disease requires self-management and education, and this has proved tricky even in rich countries. Now, this process of epidemiological transition is far from over. It's going to continue, and it's going to continue in a very interesting way that actually affects all of us, even people living in high-income countries. So stay tuned and find out more. But first, a big thank you to the University of Edinburgh for sponsoring this video. The University of Edinburgh has a fantastic online MPH program. What really impresses me about the University of Edinburgh's online MPH is that it prepares graduates to solve real and current public health problems. Doing the University of Edinburgh's online MPH will prepare you for an exciting career in public health. So if you're interested, click on the link in the description below. So we've said that this process of epidemiological transition isn't over. Let's take a look at what the future holds. I think that the most important change that we're going to see in the medium to long term is the re-emergence of infectious disease, even in high-income countries. This is going to be driven by two things. Firstly, increasing antimicrobial resistance. And secondly, the increasing emergence of novel zoonotic infections. So let's just take a look at each of these. Increasingly, we're seeing infectious diseases that are difficult and in some cases impossible to treat with antibiotics and other antimicrobials. So in a sense, there's this ongoing race between humans trying to develop new drugs to treat infectious disease and microbes developing new resistance strategies. And let's be clear, with respect to this particular race, we are on their turf. Microbes have evolved over billions of years to be very, very good at adapting to changes in microchemical environments. In 2016, we saw nearly 500,000 new cases of multidrug-resistant tuberculosis. We're seeing resistance emerging to HIV treatment, to malaria treatment. We're seeing increased incidence of methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus and carbapenemase-producing enterobacteriaceae and other resistant organisms in hospitals. Without question, this increase in antimicrobial-resistant organisms is going to be one of the biggest public health challenges facing us in the future. And to make matters worse, we're seeing an increase in the incidence of novel zoonotic infections. A zoonotic infection happens when a microbe jumps from an animal host to infect humans. And in just the last few decades, we've seen HIV, we've seen SARS, we've seen MERS-CoV, we've seen Ebola, we've seen many, many novel zoonotic infections jump from animal hosts to humans and then spread across country borders. And given existing and increasing population density and the fact that in any 1 year, more than 1 billion people move from one place to another, we're likely to see more and more of these novel zoonotic infections and other infections spread across country borders and threaten global health security. Now, I have created a video on pandemics, so if you're interested in global health security, check that out. Subscribe to this channel if you haven't already, and a big thank you to those of you that are supporting this channel through patreon.com. I couldn't do this without you. And a huge thank you to the University of Edinburgh. Thanks for supporting this channel. If you want to do an MPH online, check out their webpage. Click on the link in the description below.